Annie, how are you?
Hello, I'm doing well.
Good to see you.
Thank you. I missed our first meeting last week.
Did you have a chance to see? I think it's still available on video.
Oh, okay. I'll have to go back and do it.
Yeah, okay. I'll make sure it gets sent out. I think they're all going to be, they'll be sustainable on video. So I just don't know where they're going to live. I'm not really sure.
Okay.
Hey, Val, can you tell or put in the chat where they can find the links to this Zoom meetings? Are they sent out through Astara? People miss them and they want to review. Glad everybody is early because there's a lot to cover today. It's good. And you can go to astara.org/events, and that's where you'll find the videos for the past meetings.
Thank you.
Welcome. So once you RSVP to an event, you'll be sent the Zoom login information 1 hour prior to the event. And this is for security reasons for all the Zoom meetings. Okay, there's another. Okay. Well, good afternoon, good evening, everyone, all Astarians. My name is Anthony Gadara. We're here for our next little delve into the teachings. There was a lot of, you know, originally I wanted to look at both lessons three and four, but there's so much information in the fourth degree that I wanted to just get to that, so that we can again go through it and practice and experiment, so that it will hopefully become experiential. And then when we get towards the end, I'll tie them both together, both last week, this week, and where we'll be in the future and why these are, for me, relevant. Again, I take that back to the adage of the light bulb and being plugged in. And I think it's really important that as we, the individuals, practice and it becomes experiential, then it's easier for us to convey those teachings to someone else or to help a fellow Astarian when it's experiential, because then we can go right back to the book and then read and have them experiment or look at what the objections are. And if it's possible to dismantle those objections, then dismantle them and let them experience that, that other side, because there's always two sides to a coin, right? So before I always begin, I always like to invoke. So if we remember from the last week's, we did an invocation. So we'll take this from the first degree. It's from lesson two, and we'll do a quick invocation to kind of plug us in. So if you guys are ready, we can. To the causal logos, the great architect of the universe, supreme God, heavenly father, heavenly mother, to the Lord Yehoshua Bar Miriam, to the Lord Christ, to the Lord Buddha, to all the great ones. If you have a particular spiritual teacher, please ask for their blessings. I'll acknowledge my teacher, Holy Master Cho Kok Sui, Buddha Padmasambhava, Robert and Arlene Cheney, Bodhisattva Kutumi, Lord Rama, Lord Zoser, to the Astarian hierarchy. We humbly invoke for your great blessings. May we be a channel through which thy holy ones approach the world. May we be a center for the radiation of thy power. Teach us to travel light, that we may better gain the heights. Break the bonds that bind. Teach us to give ourselves entirely to thy service, to attune ourselves to thy will. Teach us to lay down the small personal life for the greater cosmic life, and to love with the love of God in full faith. So be it. How's everybody feel with that? Thumbs up, chat box, everybody okay? So we will go back and cover the aspects of the mystery schools in lesson three, because I think they're really important for the obvious reasons of where the teachings came from and how they came to us, why they come to us, which I think it's important. And look at the law of cycles, right? What is up must come down. What is down must come up. It's a law of cycle, right? We have daily cycles. We have monthly cycles. We have zodiacal cycles. Everything is a cycle. So if we look at the rise of the mysteries, we also look at the fall of the mysteries and why that's important and how that comes about. Because I think it's important. And there's a lot to look at. And I wanted to move into lesson four, because it begins pretty much where we picked up from the invocation, and that is with who are our masters? Who are our teachers? And if we look at lesson four in the opening of that first degree, it's the cosmic chemistry of prayer and the steps to healing. I remember reading in the Holy Master Joel Kuhl through Alice Bailey said that all dis-ease is a manifestation of inhibited soul life. And I didn't quite understand the depth of that at the time that I read it, but as I went through and continued to progress through the teachings, it made sense. So do we have a mental body which allows us to process thoughts and ideas? Yeah. Do we have an emotional body which allows us to feel? Yes. When you get upset, where do you feel it the most? Do you feel it like in your stomach, in the solar plexus, right? So we also have a physical body which allows us to act and to move. So dis-ease, not just disease, but dis-ease is a manifestation of inhibited soul life somewhere in the bodies, in the vehicles. Where are they? Well, where do they start? Where does it typically start? It starts from the mind, right? And how we process that. So I think that the steps to healing, releasing areas of dis-ease or disease, and it's brilliant because we're going to do this meditation that's in here that was given to Astara. I think it's brilliant. And again, if we look at the individual, who we are as individuals, and our ability to stay whole, to stay healthy, to be united with whatever that is for you and whomever those teachings represent for you, so that we can be a channel for those energies, those blessings, and that healing for other people. Because if it works for us, will it work for others? Yes. Are we all one? Yes. So I want to start with the first. If you guys want to join me, you can go to page one, first degree, lesson four. And I'm going to refer to not Jesus, but Yehoshua in his Aramaic name, Yehoshua the Christ, incarnated during the days of these early mystery schools. Though already a master, he nevertheless sought the mysteries in Egypt, Tibet, and India. Astara embraces the esoteric teachings of all the major religions. You'll find the mystical truths of many of the world's religions and spiritual movements revered and revealed in these lessons, but it is mystical Christianity which will be the most thoroughly presented since we are most familiar with it. However, as there were beings sent from higher dimensions to teach in earlier mystery schools, so are there now great master teachers working through modern day mystery schools. And we share the following information about Astara's teachers to provide a complete knowledge of the source of the ancient wisdom found in Astara's lessons. So let's take a look at the Astarian spiritual masters. Obviously, we know the first one is Yehoshua, the Lord Yehoshua. If we look at the next teacher that is listed, it's the Master Rama. There's an ancient Indian epic called the Ramayana, which depicts the story of the triumph of good over evil. The bearer of light in this historic drama was a great one named Rama. The name Rama is interpreted to mean the divine son of holy breath. Holy breath being the combined father, mother, God. Ra, related to the father of light. Ma, to the mother of light. It is pronounced Rama. In the ancient days when the mysteries were being taught, one was given the name Rama upon completion of an initiation. The sacred name was again passed on by this teacher to another disciple gaining initiation. In this way, the name Rama has been transferred from teacher to disciple for unnumbered ages. During the days when the master Yehoshua taught the mysteries in Egypt, came one from the east seeking initiation. It was during this incarnation that this disciple gained mastership and was given the spiritual name Rama. There is a lineage of master teachers who bear the name of Rama, but it is this Rama, teacher who last incarnated during the time of Yehoshua, who has been led to teach at Astara's mystery school. He has not incarnated since. The Master Kutumi. We have long assumed this great one to be of Kashmirian origin, though he has neither affirmed nor denied this assumption. He seems to attach little import to the place or time of his last birth. His interests cover the entire globe, and his vision projects into the higher ethers of the Aquarian age. Kutumi claims no nationality. He belongs to no nation, nor to any particular people. The entire planet is his home, and he accepts all the people of Earth as his family. What is important is that in his youth, he attached himself to no particular religious faith. His youthful mind reached for the mysteries with which he was familiar, having been a Hierophant high instructor in earlier incarnations. He continually traveled to distant lands, gaining a broader education and concentrating especially on the varied religions of different cultures, most notably Buddhism. He settled in Tibet after his last incarnation, began teaching within higher dimensions. Although he dwelt in the valley of the Himalayas, much of his work was on the higher planes. Unlike Rama, Kutumi has worked with several spiritual organizations and mystery schools. It is said he was partially, instrumental in the teachings of the Theosophical Society in the early 1880s. It is the same Kutumi who has guided Erlin's life and writing mystery since her birth. He is my spiritual guide and teacher who contacted me in my early days and who I came to call the Father. He is the same unseen one mentioned in my book, Remembering. He has faithfully devoted his efforts to channeling the teachings of the ancient mysteries in the degree lessons of Astara's Book of Life and the great work of the Penetralia. The name Kutumi is a mystical name taken from the name of the Kut Humpa sect of the Tibetan Buddhism. Pa means disciples of. The Master Kutumi spent several years as a Buddhist monk of the Gelupa or Yellow Hat division of Tibetan Buddhism. In Tibet, his name is pronounced Ketumba. The Master Zosa. It was in 1951 that Robert felt inspired to resign the offices to be held in a spiritual organization headquartered in Michigan and Indiana. Following his resignation, we entered our retreat from the world, a tiny cottage in Indiana, seeking every possible inspiration and guideline in planning our journey to California to open the New Age Center that was to be called Stara, a place of light. Suddenly one evening, in the midst of our meditations, we both clairvoyantly perceived somewhat of his features and heard his name spoken. He was indeed a majestic being. Our intuitive perceptions indicated he was concerned with the potential healing work of Astara, how it would come to be one of Astara's most important functions. When we were impressed with his name, Zoser, it meant little to either of us. We attached no historical importance to him, nor did he project any impression concerning his true identity. Our visionary glimpses of his headdress and robes only revealed that he was an ancient Egyptian. We learned that he was a pharaoh in the third dynasty of ancient Egypt, and it was during his reign that the first pyramid was constructed, the Step Pyramid at Saqqara, which may be the oldest building on Earth today. We know that the Step Pyramid, Zoser's Pyramid, was never intended to be his burial site, but was used as a temple of initiation in the mysteries, and that Zoser himself was Aerophant of the temple. The name Zoser was given to him at birth. It means the holy, for his birth had been prophesied by the seers of his day. Strange and mystical circumstances surrounding his birth marked him as an expected one, and his coming fulfilled the words of the prophecy. His first initiation was bestowed on him while he was still a boy. During this initiation, a new name was added to that of Zoser. It was Netraket, which means God in flesh, further signifying the esteem in which he was held. Zoser, Netraket, was deemed divine by his subjects, and indeed a divine radiance surrounds him even now, whenever he chooses to appear to some Astarian. He traveled throughout Egypt and united his people to the first time in their history. Wars ceased during his reign. Under his rule, world civilization was born. It is through the efforts of this singular being that the healing work of Astara began. We cannot but pay profound homage to Zoser, this great one, who so strives to remain in the background of Astarian activities, but who, because of the fruits of his miracles, cannot but shine as an ever-increasing light in all our hearts. The Master Zoser has been directed from higher dimensions to work with this mystery school's students. When an Astarian makes a written affirmation for either physical or spiritual health, Zoser works with the student's higher consciousness to create an energy vortex for healing work. He clearly says he is but a conduit in this process, and that the greater healing work is done by the Astarian's own affirmations on health. I think this is really, really important to understand what our connection is. And I think for me personally, why a continual invocation and that continual work within the hierarchy of the Astarian hierarchy is important, so that we can continue to build our connection to this great these great beings so that we can be a conduit for those forces of light while we are here in order to help others on the path. The Master Astalaya. When Astalaya presented its first services in Astara in 1951, a woman, Mildred, was a constant attendee. She had been a nurse, retired from the US government service. Before Astara was founded, she had been a member of the mystical organization named the Order of the Grail. Members of that order had been disbanded and directed to affiliate with and serve other organizations when needed, provided such organizations exemplified high standards in quality of philosophy. Mildred selected Astara, to which she became exclusively devoted, and which she served for many years during her earth life under the direction of her master teacher, Lama Seya. We do not know how many lifetimes she spent studying and practicing the Healy arts. We do know you could have found her among the Essenes at the Qumran community of that order. Her connection with the Essenes, evidenced by her manner and her lifelong interests and activities in her recent incarnation, would demonstrate to any student of Essenian philosophy that she was living that life over again. If you haven't read the Essenes or some of the writings on the Essenes, I would recommend those as well. They're great, great writings. We have Erlen Chaney, the author and channeler of these degree lessons, journeying to the higher life on May 23rd, 1997, nearly a century after she, or half century after she and Robert founded Astara. During that time, she channeled 7 of the 8 degrees of these lessons, authored 21 books, gave countless seminars across the country, led numerous tours to mystical sites around the world, and spent innumerable hours in prayer and meditation, asking for divine guidance and inspiration to overshadow her teachings and writings, and praying for help and healing for all Astarians. During the last 2 days of her physical life, she spent much time consciously, metaphysically releasing the eternal seed atoms which accompanied her into physical incarnation. She spoke often to Robert and their daughter Sita, who shared with her the vigil and initiation of the great journey. I will always be and with Astaria, Astarians and Astara. With that simple but profoundly meaningful statement, she assured them and all who seek through Astara that she is at their side as she has had ever been. Universal soul as she is also individual to each of us as she strives now even more strongly from the higher dimensions of life to touch each of us, to comfort us, to inspire us, to heal us, to help us laugh. She will ever be a master teacher of Astara for all Astarians. Robert Chaney began his life's mission in the spiritualist tradition and a powerful vision, ended any doubt as to whether he should further pursue his growing business career or enter into a life of ministry in the spiritualist Episcopal Church. He soon established a solid reputation in his own right as a medium, spirit, photographer, and psychic. It was at the Spiritualist Center of Camp Chesterfield in Indiana that he met Erlen Cantrell. They soon became partners for life in marriage, in mission, and service to humankind. For over 50 years, Robert wrote, taught, and spoke with knowledge and experience on an almost limitless number of esoteric topics. He touched in one way or another an untold number of souls in search of more, in search of non-punishing, non-limiting, experiential, lasting, and sustaining spiritual growth and illumination. He believed strongly that as a teacher, he was also a perpetual student. Erlen, his beloved wife and partner in all things, credited Robert with being her rock, her anchor, and with encouraging her to grow and shine and serve in ways in which only she could. He selflessly lived his beliefs throughout his life of service with no line of demarcation between personal or professional. For Robert, it was all a walk on a path toward light. I would absolutely agree with that. I think that's all what we're doing is we're all on a path toward light. The Masters of Astara. Astara is the realization of many dreams of Zoser, Kutumi, Rama, Astalaya, Erlen, and Robert, because it is a living, breathing exponent of all basic religions, simultaneously embracing the tenets of both ancient mysticism and modern philosophies. Rama, who particularly helped and guided Robert, concentrates on ways of expanding Astara's teachings worldwide. He works to create the path of enlightenment for all seekers and safeguards the wisdom and truth of this mystery school for future generations. Kutumi, universal teacher that he is, impresses and inspires with teachings of the degree lessons in Astara's Book of Life, the great work of the Penetralia. He continues to provide Astara with knowledge and wisdom from higher dimensions. Zoser overshadows Astara's healing ministry and aspires to spread the wisdom of assisted self-healing throughout our planet. Astalea works with members to help them develop psychic abilities and other skills that will assist them on their individual paths. From the other side, Erlen and Robert continue to participate in every aspect of Astara. They continue to speak to you through these pages, through their books. There are now even greater efforts on your behalf for assistance and healing through cosmic help or healing petitions. Their spirits stand ever ready to comfort and guide you in every way possible, just as they always did on the earth plane. I wanted to take my time with all of this because I think the details are important. It's kind of like a recipe. If you leave something out, you don't get the same thing, and you can't really reproduce it if you don't follow the recipe. So I think the details are important because it provides the foundation with which we build our light bodies. And why that's important is going back to dis-ease as a manifestation of inhibited soul life, why that's important, we think about the healing petitions that are sent into Astara and the etheric link between those petitions and those that are requesting healing or prayer or support, and why that's important. As new petitions are received, they are placed in the healing chest. Petitions that have had our prayers for about a month are removed to make room for new arrivals. Therefore, it'd be helpful for you to forward a new petition every 3 or 4 weeks until you reach the desired state of health. Otherwise, with the removal of your earlier petition, your direct connection to healing chest is broken. I like to touch on this because it kind of goes back to repetition, right? And we can't sometimes just only make one petition and think that that's going to rectify a wrong. And we're going to get into this a little bit later where they talk about the sins of the father are visited upon four generations, right? And Erlen talks about this as being the life of seven past incarnations, okay? And it's usually the most four recent incarnations that the incarnated soul are having to deal with based on thoughts, emotions, speech, and actions that are lodged in the three seeds. So why is this important? I think it's important because, again, like I mentioned before, if I take a path through a field every day and it's a path of wheat or a path of grass, it doesn't make any difference for 30 or 40 years. What if I took that same path for 4 or 5 incarnations and I stopped for one incarnation? Is the habit still there? I stop walking in a field for 30, 40 years and I stop for one day and I come back. Likewise, if it was 4 or 5 incarnations and now I look back, is that momentum of habit still there? Yes, it is. So how do we adjust or readjust that habit? I think it's, for me, it's invocation. It's invocation, it's prayer, it's humility. It's allowing the teachings to work through you so they become experiential so that you can be a messenger of light, okay? Is it easy? If it were, there'd be no reason to be here. Nobody ever fell to the top of any ladder, did they? They had to climb, right? So we have to expect resistance, and that resistance is good because it's what develops our character. It helps us to develop our character. And I think that without that challenge, we crumble. And part of the challenge is, of those challenges, the challenges of the challenge is that we're never really taught how to deal with challenge. And so a lot of times we have a tendency to give up and we will temporarily fail because we think that the challenges are too great, or it wasn't meant to be, or I couldn't do it. Well, did we give up? Did we acquiesce to the challenge thinking it hadn't really manifested? And I take that to Einstein, who failed 10,000 times in the pursuit of the light, right? And here we are. So don't give up, persevere, and reach out if you need help, because the Astarians are here you have prayer petitions, prayer requests, send those in, and we will obviously, we bless those and heal those that have sent those in, and we will continue to do that. So the four steps to healing, if we go to page 18, when the body becomes ill, what is wrong and what could be done about it? In addition to whatever help traditional Western medicine can offer, from the viewpoint of Astara, there are four things to be considered for self-healing: homeopathic remedies, healing herbs, indrawing and directing prana, the white light, which harmonizes force centers of the etheric body called chakras. An entire lesson, number 11, is devoted to the chakras. Training the subconscious mind by visualizing and affirming perfection. Transforming the physical form through the chemistry of prayer. There's some deep, deep dialogue in this, okay? And very succinct dialogue. And words are important. And I think if we read these, training the subconscious mind by visualizing and affirming perfection. The challenge with the subconscious mind is because it is subconscious, we're not really aware of it. We don't really have access to it, right? So we have access to our thoughts. We can think, we can intuit, we can, you know, an idea will pass. The subconscious is below our ability to actually reach it, but we can reach it by visualizing and affirming perfection. We have a mental body, we have an emotional body, we have an etheric double, and we have a physical body, right? So by visualizing and affirming and continue that, we can maybe readjust those patterns that we have had through this lifetime and potentially, possibly, past incarnations to readjust that north, that true north that we're seeking. I think about adjusting just 1 degree. If we were to adjust this 1 degree and we left the earth for the moon, would we miss the moon by just being off by 1 degree from here? Probably yes. But think about what that could mean in future incarnations if we just adjust 1 degree. So don't let the challenge of the present deter you from seeking that change. Trust, because if it weren't to be, they wouldn't have written it in these books. And it wouldn't have been gifted to Erlen and Robert and to past teachers through their schools with the teachings from the hierarchy. And I think that's important. So don't give up, persevere, and know you have help. Prana and the white light. Second and urgently important is the indrawing and directing of prana, the white light, which harmonizes the chakras. We have already mentioned that the etheric form is composed of four ethers differing one from the other in rate of vibration. When we think of ether, we think of air. When we think of air, we think of breathing. We have said that illness may possibly result from a faulty connection between the etheric form and the physical, such an illness may be directly due to a lack of ether. The ancients referred to this healing ether as prana. The term prana is difficult to define. It's derived from Sanskrit, and there is no equivalent English word. In an effort to select one which might convey the proper meaning, I must choose the word breath. And yet prana is not breath as we interpret it. I might select the word life, yet prana is not life. I might then combine these two definitions and call it the breath of life. And although I would have arrived at a definite aspect of prana, which is indeed the breath of life, still it is only one aspect. To define it clearly, I must revert to the teachings of the ancients. The entire universe, from God to the earth, is the product of one substance. Remember that invocation that we use to the great architect of the universe. The supreme being, the causal logos, the causal cause, right? The product of that one substance. The ancients called it Akash. It is the primary and basic substance out of which the earth and the heavens are made. All are composed of the same substance. With this difference, in one field of expression, its manifestations are subtle and invisible, In the other, they are visible. I want to go back. The product of one substance, the great architect, all are composed of the same substance. We are all composed of the same substance of the great architect. Do we have different vehicles? Yes. Did God give us one thing that is incredibly beneficent? It's free will. And it's not free because we end up having to endure the consequences of our choices, our thoughts, emotions, speech, and actions. Or what are we doing to align ourselves with that one substance and try to maintain that consistency? It is a challenge. It is a great challenge. And that's why we're here in a body. That's why we're going through what we're going through, to try to reconnect to that one substance and remember that we are all one. We are all in this. And how can we do that? Well, I think it's, again, it's like that recipe, okay? It's one step at a time. Flowing out of the basic invisible substance are several vital forces. One force is called Azoth, which, regenerating and revitalizing the mental spheres, is mind force. Another, acting upon the substance, creates forms out of it and imbues them with life force. This primary vital life force we call prana. Without the activity of prana upon Akash, the basic substance remains in a state of darkness, without form and void. We cannot see prana, only the manifestation of it. But then neither can we see the wind, only its manifestation. In electricity, we see one manifestation of prana. Above and beyond electricity, the mysterious prana, the vital life force, sweeps on into the great unknown from whence it came. Ascending into the higher spheres, it evolves into even more refined energies, known by other names, about which we shall teach in later lessons. I refer to the electric spiritual force in the physical body. The positive-negative forces, the elements and chemicals absorbed into your body from the food you eat and the liquids you drink, create a life force with a negative polarity. They are composed of solids, liquids, and gases on the earth plane and are material in nature. Earth is a gigantic reservoir of negative polarity. These negative elements and chemicals are absorbed into the bloodstream and proceed to the heart. The heart pumps them into the lungs. There they interfuse with prana, which, since it is a solar force, is a force with positive polarity. This interfused positive-negative force is absorbed into the bloodstream like the earth absorbs dew. It is to the etheric form what oxygen is to the physical. This positive-negative life force flows throughout the body, charging each cell with renewed energy. There's a lot of information in those last two paragraphs, a lot of information. Okay. And again, we think about positive and negative. If we look at polarity, okay, one basically can push the other away, right? So if we have positive and negative, we have male, female, right? We have positive, we have negative. We have, think about the principles of electricity. If there is resistance or impurities in that copper wire, what does that cause? When that electricity is trying to flow through, do you know what it causes? Resistance, and it causes heat. Okay, so let's transfer heat. What does resistance mean within our process? If we resist an idea, do we dismiss it? What happens to it? Does the idea still exist? What if that were an aspect from the one substance that is trying to communicate to us? Do we just cut ourselves off from that by dismissing it? I think we do, right? Until we can understand experientially why it was actually brought to us. There's a lot of levels to truth, right? You have the truth at face value. You have the symbolic truth. You have the esoteric truth. And she mentions a little bit about that, exoteric and esoteric, okay? And why I wanted to get to this is because if we look at the power of the white light, which is what we use for healing, it's important because Does white contain all the colors? Yes. How many colors are there? 7, right? So out of those 7 colors, the pure white light contains all, right? And we're going to experiment with this because that's why she wrote it. That's why it was given to us. It's for us to experiment with so that it becomes experiential and it becomes, I want it to be molecular. I want to get it down into every one of our molecules, right? And so we're going to, do this, the prayer on the white light. Everybody, if you want, or if you can, just sit quietly. Just relax with your palms facing up, your feet apart. Make sure that your feet are not crossed yet. So make sure that your feet are basically open and apart. Now just imagine, if you want, you can connect the tip of the tongue to the palate. That also connects the channel and allows the energy to circulate. Close your eyes gently. Just take a couple of nice slow inhalations and exhalations. Now imagine coming down, entering the top of the head and through the crown, a beautiful river of white light coming down through the Sushumna Nadi, through the spinal cord, sweeping down the spinal column, going out through the spine and also continuing down the legs and out through the soles of the feet down into the earth. Imagining it flowing out and away from the body, down into the earth, deep, deep, deep into the earth, carrying with it any affliction in any and all negativity. Again, imagine this brilliant, beautiful light, this river of light. We're going to try a little bit of an invocation on this as we're imagining this beautiful white light, this river of light, entering the head, into the crown. In the head, it's surrounding the frontal, the temporal, the occipital, the parietal, the cerebellum, the cerebrum, the dendrogyrus, the Brodmann's area, 1, 2, 3, 4, all areas of the brain. The medulla oblongata, the pituitary, and the pineal. This river of light is flowing into the eyes and the ears, the mouth, into the teeth, the jaws, down to the thyroid and the throat, coming down into the chest, gently into the heart, into the right atrium, the left atrium, the right ventricle, the left ventricle, gently and lovingly cleansing and purifying. Cleansing and purifying all the valves, the pulmonary, the aortic, the tricuspid, the mitral. Cleansing and purifying into the lungs. Cleansing and purifying the bronchi tree, all bronchi. All the lobes of the lungs, all the alveoli are cleansed and purified. It's coming into the esophagus and down into the stomach, to the fundus, the body, the pylorus, into the duodenum, down into the jejunum, the small intestine. Coming down into the liver, cleansing and purifying the liver in the pure white light. The pancreas is filled with the pure white light. The gallbladder, the spleen, gently and lovingly filled with the pure white light. All the internal organs, continuing down the spine and the Sushumna Nadi, down into the jejunum and the ileum, down into the large intestine, the appendix, the cecum, the ascending colon, the hepatic flexure, the transverse colon, the splenic flexure, descending sigmoid, the rectum and the anus, coming down through the base of the spine, into the reproductive organs, cleansing and purifying in the pure white light, down into the legs, the hips, the thighs, the knees, the calves, the soles of the feet, down into the earth. And just silently and mentally affirm, I am surrounded by the pure white light of the Christ. This river of white light is sweeping away all areas of inhibited soul life. I release these down into the earth. I release all areas mentally, emotionally, etherically, energetically, physically, atomically and subatomically, release down into the earth all areas of inhibited soul life. I am surrounded by the pure white light of the Christ, the pure white light of the Buddha, the pure white light of Kutumi, the pure white light of Rama, the pure white light of Dzogchen, the pure white light of the great avatar of the Astarian hierarchy, the pure white light of the great avatar of this new Aquarian age. We release all dis-ease. We are a fountain of light. If there are any areas that you feel or you see darkness, just allow that river of white light to just sweep this away. The shoulders, the upper arms, the elbows, the hands, out through the fingers, down the spine, out through the base of the spine, through the entire legs, both legs, out through the soles of the feet, deep into the earth. I am filled with the pure white light. Now I'd like you to keep your palms facing up and just lock your auric field by crossing your feet and your hands together. So just cross your feet, cross your hands together. In draw the white light and let's fill the aura with it. So now this light, which was passing through, coming out through the soles of the feet and through the base of the spine, is now starting to fill up. Filling up the feet, the toes, the feet, the ankles, into the calves and the knees, the upper thighs and the hips, the reproductive organs, the base of the spine, the colon, the kidneys, and the adrenals, all the internal organs, filling up the lungs with the pure white light of the Christ. Up into the lungs, every cell of the body, every cell of the blood, the space surrounding every cell. We release any and all negative picture images in the blood. May these be released. We are filled with the pure white light of the Christ. Coming up to the shoulders, running down into the fingers, into the hands, into the wrists and forearms, elbows, to the upper arms and shoulders, coming up into the neck, into the head, feeling all areas of the brain. This pure white light. I am filled with the pure white light of the Christ. Continue to silently and mentally affirm, the love of my heart pervades the world. There is not one being in all the world this love has passed over. It is suffusing every atom, every being of the world. This light flows from a heart grown great with love and mighty and far reaching beyond measure. I am surrounded by the pure white light of the Christ. Only good can come to me. Only good shall go from me. I give thanks. I give thanks. I give thanks. Just remain peaceful and calm. Keep your tongue connected. Hold firmly to the faith that the white light which you are indrawing is flowing to you, filling your aura, every cell, the space surrounding every cell, radiating into your bloodstream, restoring you to wholeness, physically, energetically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually. Just gently sit, quietly visualizing that the crown chakra is vibrantly throwing out sparks of the white light, very much like a sparkler used by children for the 4th of July. Imagine that it shoots the life forces upward above the head, and that the light particles then fall down throughout the aura, permeating it with electromagnetic energy until the entire aura is filled with this glowing, sparkling light. Imagine that this white spark flows from a fluid action like a fountain. See the flow pulsating with spiritual power. I am surrounded by the pure white light of the Christ, the pure white light of the Buddha, the pure white light of Kutumi, the pure white light of Rama, the pure white light of Dzogchen, the pure white light of the great avatars of the Astarian hierarchy. Every cell in my body is a power plant, discharging energies throughout my physical form. Imagine every cell filled with this brilliant fountain of light. And imagine each one of these lights with the Om symbol. Om. Om. Gently be aware of your physical body. Gently come back to your body. How do you feel? Was that experiential? Thank you, Peggy. Namaste, precious soul. I think that, again, the more that we experience and we make these teachings experiential, the brighter our lights are to oppose those other forces that are out there, which can pull us in one direction or the other. And I think it's important. And again, Astara is a place of light, and the teachings are, they're amazing. I hope today's session was beneficial. I hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to send an email, or if you want to place anything in the chat box, you can. We have a few minutes here. I can answer some questions. And if not, then I would just suggest that you just maintain that state of peace and enjoy the bliss and enjoy the teachings. And in your own way, we should give thanks, huh? Let's give thanks before. To the causal logos, to the great architect of the universe, the supreme being, Heavenly Father, Heavenly Mother, to the Lord Yehoshua Bar Miriam, the Lord Christ, the Lord Buddha, all the great, great ones. If you have a spiritual teacher, please acknowledge them. I acknowledge my teacher, Holy Master Cho Koksui, Buddha Padmasambhava, Robert and Arlen Cheney, Bodhisattva Kutumi, Lord Rama, Lord Zoser, the Astarian hierarchy. To all of our celestial guides, our angel guides, to our spiritual elders, and to our higher souls, we thank you, thank you, thank you for these great, great blessings. May we continue to be a channel through which thy holy ones approach the world. May we continue to be a center for thy radiation of thy power. Teach us to travel light, that we may better gain the heights, break the bonds that bind. Teach us to give ourselves entirely to thy service, to attune ourselves to thy will. Teach us to lay down the small personal life for the greater cosmic life, and to love with the love of God in full faith. Amen. So be it. Is everybody good? How are you feeling, Anne? You feel good? William, how you doing? Peggy, you're good? Good, good, good. Okay. Well, if there aren't any questions, I will say namaste, salutations, and I look forward to seeing you on the next version of Book of Life. We'll see what we do. I there's still some more in this fourth degree that I want to cover. So we just didn't have time today because, again, I want to make each one of these experiential from the standpoint of the teaching so that we have something that is concrete. It's really, it's experiential. And I can't fake your experiences. And I think that as you experience this, it will help anchor that light within us, release the darkness or any of that opposing energy so that we can continue to build Astara for future. So thank you, thank you, thank you, everyone. Namaste. Have a beautiful, beautiful night. Have a beautiful afternoon. And until we see each other again, namaste.